I'm Mandy Miller, and I actually grew up in church. From the time I was very young, I was at church pretty much every weekend, and I was just a good girl. And I came from a good family with good parents. I got good grades. I was a good friend, and I'd say you could just define me as good for a long, long time. I guess as I started getting older, I stayed a good girl compared to the rest of the world. I was always known for being a church girl, and so for that reason, I would actually try to discredit my faith. I would justify it and say that that because I went to church and because I called myself a Christian, it had nothing to do with why I was good. I was just a good person. And so I always grew up knowing that that Jesus Christ had died on a cross for me. I called him Lord, and I went to every church event, every youth event. I sang in every choir and participated in every church function you possibly could. But there was just a lot of knowledge, and there was nothing personal there. And so as I got older, I think I continued to compare myself to other people, and it didn't come from a healthy place at all. And so I was not secure at all. And as much as I appeared to be selfless and have the servant's heart and just be so good to all these people, it came from a very unhealthy place within. And so what people didn't know in our relationships was that as hard as I was trying to earn their love. And so it came from a very selfish place. So I would do things for you. I would serve you. I would try to take care of you so that you would love me, because I wanted to be indisposable and I wanted to be irreplaceable. And I wanted to know that I had this place in your life that no one else could have. And so as good as I was, I guess I never really thought I needed a savior. I earned my way to heaven, and Christ died on the cross for me, and I understood that it was no more for me than anybody else, and as much as he might have loved me, he loved everybody. And so it was just kind of this blanket salvation, and I didn't feel like it was special to me at all. And so I ended up moving here almost 4 years ago, and I had gone through a series of circumstances that just continued to just break down my confidence, and I definitely had an issue with just putting people on pedestals. And so if ever there was another God in my life, it was always other people, and I would worship them and just idolize them and want to be like them. And at the same time, I would compare myself to them and have this inward rivalry, and I would want to be more like them, but I was constantly looking for a reason to tear them down internally and bring them back down so they wouldn't be on this pedestal, and so that maybe, hopefully, I would stand a chance in comparison to them. And so I moved here, and I started coming to church here. I stopped going to church in college. I just had fun and did what college kids do, and just decided that, it was a time in my life. My dad was a pastor, and I didn't have a home church, and so he was retired, and I didn't really have a church I thought of to go to, and so I just stopped. And after college, I thought, I need to get back into being a good person again. I don't know where my life's going, so let's start with getting involved in church. And I ended up moving here from Maryland, and that was the first thing, on my to-do list was go to that church I had seen at the beach. And so I show up here, and I went to the traditional service, and 1122 was just starting. I got here in August, and they started in September. And I remember I signed up for a Jamaica mission trip, and I attended 1122 strictly because it was right before our mission meeting one Sunday. And I came and I was so distracted by the people, and I remember just watching and staring and completely judging and thinking these people were crazy that they worship with their eyes closed and their hands up, and who does that? Like, you know, I sang out of a hymnal and you sang four verses to the same tune, and it just had never been that emotional experience for me. And so I ended up, I had signed up for this mission trip. I didn't even have a job yet. I didn't know where money would come from, but I had been on some local missions before growing up, you know, the good girl that I was, and always had a passion for it, but I never knew why. I couldn't explain it. It was the one time that I felt like something at my inner core was truly good, and I knew I wasn't trying to earn anything from anybody, but I truly just was passionate about serving. And so I was excited to plug into this mission trip and, you know, thought that I had this experience and I knew what to expect. And as it turned out, had absolutely no idea what was coming. And so I get to Jamaica with, I don't know, probably 50 other people that I didn't know. And one day I'm riding on the bus with Joby, and he just sits there and he asks me to tell him how I met Christ and when I met Christ. And I just threw my hands up and I was like, Joby, will you just explain what that means? Like, what do you mean, when did I meet Christ? I never shook his hand. It's my understanding he's been there since I was born. I've gone to church my whole life. And he just looked at me and he said, so you were a good girl. And I was like, well, yeah, I guess I was. And I had always kind of taken pride in that. And no sooner did he say that than he started to explain having a relationship with Christ. And it's crazy to even talk about, but I had never heard the gospel presented that way. And so to me, Christ was always, you know, this far-off Savior who died for all of us. But, you know, I was good. I didn't really need all that grace. I hadn't rebelled enough to really need a Savior, so I thought. And so the more we talked about it, and the more he just shared about, you know, God, yes, Christ died on a cross for everybody, but specifically Christ died for you, and you need a Savior because you can't do it on your own, and compared to a perfect God, you're not that good. And I think for the first time in my life, I was called out in a way that I always feared and I never thought I would be. And so I started to realize that all the things that I knew all along were going on inside me, and all the ways that, you know, I tried to impress people and I tried to be good and I would try to bring them back down off that pedestal that I had put them on, and I would serve them selfishly so that they would want me more and like me more and all that, that was my pride. And pride as a sin trumps them all. And so I truly had lived my life all for me. It was all about me. And so whether that was portrayed in insecurities or this false sense of selflessness, it was pride. And I was living all for me and all for what I wanted people to perceive about me and how I wanted to come across, and you know, about my image and about all these things. And so I worshiped other people and I worshiped the reputation that I wanted for myself, and in doing that I had become basically my own God. And so it was on that trip that that I accepted Christ as my Savior and realized that that the gift of Christ's rescue has to be accepted. You know, that anybody can give you a gift, but if you don't accept it, then you never really get to enjoy it. You know, if you don't ever open it and take it as your own, then it never truly becomes yours. So I accepted Christ at that point, and I was thinking about it, kind of looking back in hindsight, you know, if God had made me sign a contract at that moment and said, you know, you're going to sign your life over to me and I'm going to become Lord of your life because I came and I saved you. But this is how it's going to look like. I probably wouldn't have signed the contract, and not because it wasn't good. I mean, I'm in this amazing place, but because at that point I wasn't ready for it. I wasn't ready to hear what he had to say, and I wasn't ready to know what was coming. And so, you know, had he signed that contract, there would have been crazy things that I would have laughed at, had anyone, especially God, told me. But there are things that I can see now, you know, that at that point God knew, he knew I wasn't ready to hear it, but he knew at that point that I had to let go, that I had to stop trying and stop trying to be this person and stop trying to be like everybody else so that I could be the me that he created. And there's still times that I don't know who that person is. I'm here to publicly proclaim in front of all the people that have invested in me that I do need a Savior and that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.